Okay, so this talk will indeed be about hyperfine interactions and more specifically how to calculate hyperfine interactions in Wien2K. I can imagine if this topic is announced that some people would think, hyperfine interactions, why should I care about hyperfine interactions? So let me spend this first minute to motivate you that hyperfine interactions are really meaningful. In this audience, who of you came to this conference by plane? Can you raise your hand if you came by plane? So more than one half of the people here. If you came by plane, you probably saw these type of devices. And hyperfine interactions play an important role in security checks at airports. At the end of the talk, I will explain what the connection is. Before being able to explain that, I need to go through the physics of hyperfine interactions. Karl-Heinz has shown you this slide on the very first day. And this shows how to calculate the total energy in a DFT code. And let's look specifically at this term here, where you have the electron charge density interacting with the electrostatic potential due to the nuclei. Well, it went without saying, because it is so obvious for us, that these nuclei are mathematical point charges. In reality, that is not true. A nucleus is more than a mathematical electric point charge. And that is what hyperfine interactions are about. If you want one global definition of all types of hyperfine interactions, then you can tell it this way. These are the effects that arise due to the fact that a nucleus is more than an electrical mathematical point charge. What is a nucleus then? How is it more than a point charge? Well, I will visualize this in this cartoon. At one side, you have the mathematical electric point charge. At the other side, you have a cartoon for a real nucleus. And there are two types of differences. A nucleus is not just a point charge. It's an object with a volume and a shape, typically an ellipsoid. And a nucleus is also not just an electric charge. It also has magnetic properties. It has a magnetic dipole moment, which you can visualize as a bar magnet. So a real nucleus is an ellipsoid with a bar magnet inside. That's a more realistic description of how a nucleus really looks like. And that gives the three types of hyperfine interactions immediately. You have effects that depend on this bar magnet in the nucleus. This will be the magnetic hyperfine interaction. You have an effect due to the shape of the nucleus. This will be the electric quadrupole interaction. And you have an effect due to the volume of the nucleus, not a point, but something with a volume. And that will be the monopole shift, or in some experimental contexts, the isomer shift. So we will go through these three types of hyperfine interactions, and we will start with the bar magnet. In your first course on electromagnetism, you probably studied this kind of object, a horseshoe magnet, and you examined the field lines of such a magnet. So let's watch at the field lines between the two poles of this magnet. You see that these field lines are rather parallel to each other. You have a homogeneous magnetic field there, which I can visualize in this way, a homogeneous magnetic field characterized by a vector that has the magnitude of this magnetic field from North Pole to South Pole. I will consider this horseshoe magnet as a representation for the electron cloud. The electron cloud is able to generate a magnetic field at the position of the nuclei. That is what we call the magnetic hyperfine field. But I will take this magnet as something that has the effect of the electron cloud. It's the magnet in our example that will generate that magnetic hyperfine field. Here we have this electron cloud again. It generates a magnetic field at the position of the nucleus, and the nucleus has this bar magnet inside. So this nucleus will interact with that magnetic hyperfine field. How will it do that? What will be the energy of that interaction? That's another equation you know from your introductory electromagnetism course. It's the opposite of the dot product between the nuclear magnetic moment and the hyperfine field. And this is orientation dependent, dependent on how the nucleus is oriented with respect to the hyperfine field, this energy will be different. There is a lowest energy orientation. When the north pole of the magnet is pointing to the south pole of the horseshoe magnet. So that is the ground state of that system. And we can now examine different orientations. So let us start here in the ground state. We now rotate the nucleus a little. The energy goes up. You see it on this left graph where you have it as a function of angle. And you also see it on the vertical arrow, which is just the energy. And you can rotate it further and further until you have the highest energy orientation. This is a classical situation. So if we examine what energies can be covered by all these orientations, you find this picture. The black window covers all energies for which you have one possible orientation of the nucleus. But in reality, with nuclei as quantum objects, we don't have a classical situation. We have a quantum object. And you know, in quantum physics, things are not continuous, things are quantized. This nuclear magnetic moment, that is related to an angular momentum, to the spin of the nucleus, and the orientation of that spin is quantized. So out of this continuous range of orientations, a quantum nucleus, will pick out only a discrete set of orientations. So our nuclear magnetic moment is related to an angular momentum. I take here the example of an angular momentum of one that has three possible orientations corresponding to the magnetic quantum number m being minus one, zero, or plus one. And these are three out of the continuous set of orientations. The ground state in this example is when m equals plus one, when the angular momentum is along the positive z direction. The highest energy orientation is the opposite one. By these very classical equations, we can even immediately get the Hamiltonian for this system out of this. We can take the magnetic moment operator, fill it out in this equation, take the dot product, by which we will have only the z component of the angular momentum operator, and we have right away the Hamiltonian that describes the magnetic hyperfine interaction. So if we summarize the magnetic hyperfine interaction, what do we have? And this will be repeated for all types of hyperfine interactions. At one hand, a nuclear property, which is in this case a vector, the nuclear magnetic dipole moment. At the other hand, an electron property, which is in this case again a vector, the magnetic hyperfine field. And the interaction between both gives you an energy that is given as a dot product between these two objects. And this energy, that is something that will be experimentally measurable. What Wien-2K will be able to give you is not the nuclear property. Wien-2K doesn't know anything about nuclear physics, but it can give you the electron property. This magnetic hyperfine field can be computed by Wien-2K. Now, let's elaborate a little bit on this magnetic hyperfine field. Where does it physically come from? How is the electron cloud able to generate a magnetic field at a nuclear position? There are four different contributions, and Wien-2K can calculate each of these four. And they are what is called the dipolar magnetic hyperfine field. The physics behind this is an electron has a spin. A spin is a bar magnet in the classical picture. So even if that electron would be at rest somewhere in space, the field due to that bar magnet can reach up to the nucleus. So the nucleus fields a field, and that's one contribution to the hyperfine field. A second contribution is the orbital hyperfine field. The electron has not only a spin, it also has a charge. It orbits the nucleus, so that's a tiny current. And the nucleus is therefore in the center of a current loop. Obviously, you have a magnetic field due to that current loop, the orbital hyperfine field. Then there is a term that is less easy to visualize classically. It's the Fermi contact hyperfine field. Very often, this is the dominant contribution to the hyperfine field. And it is only there when you have a spin density inside the nucleus. So when inside the volume of the nucleus, the number of spin-up electrons is different from the number of spin-down electrons. If you really want to visualize this classically, the classical analog is when you would have a dipole magnet where you can separate the north and the south pole, which is not possible in classical physics. And if you then would go in between the north and the south pole, then you would feel this contribution. And the fourth contribution is the lattice contribution to the hyperfine field. So we have the atom with the nucleus at which we want to know the hyperfine field. That atom is surrounded by neighboring atoms that can have an atomic magnetic moment. So again, bar magnets that can have fields that reach up to the nucleus. So that's the fourth and last contribution to the hyperfine field. Wien2K can calculate all of these four contributions, and on this slide it is explained where you find the information for that. I will not go in detail through this slide, but if you look at the Google Drive map which you have at the computers, you will find now a tutorial video there that describes, that gives an example how you can get for a given compound all of these four contributions. So if you follow the instructions of this video, you will be able to calculate these four properties. So by this, we have dealt with the first hyperfine interaction, the magnetic one. Let's now go to the electric hyperfine interaction, the electric quadrupole interaction, which is due to the shape of the nucleus. We introduced a horseshoe magnet for the magnetic hyperfine field. Let's search for a similar simple device that is related to the quadrupole interaction. And the first example you might think about is, let's have a parallel plate capacitor that gives us a homogeneous electric field. Just as we had a homogeneous magnetic field for the hyperfine interaction, a homogeneous electric field for the quadrupole interaction. We put our nucleus there, which is initially a point charge, and I will calculate the force that this nucleus feels in the electric field, which is, again, first year electromagnetism, the charge of the nucleus multiplied by the field. And now I replace that point nucleus by our real object, the ellipsoid, and I try to calculate the same force. Straightforward equation, we have to integrate over the volume of the nucleus and take at every point the local electric field. But the electric field is homogeneous, so it goes out of the integral, and we have just an integral over the nuclear charge that gives you the total nuclear charge again. And what do you see? No difference. The point charge nucleus and the ellipsoid, they both feel the same force. So there are no hyperfine interactions here. Hyperfine interactions were all effects that were different if the nucleus is not a point. Here, in this situation, we find the same result. That means that a homogeneous electric field is not rich enough to be able to show us an electric hyperfine interaction. We need an electric field that is a bit more complicated, an electric field that is not homogeneous, an electric field with a gradient. And let's take a very simple system that gives us a non-homogeneous electric field. I take two negative point charges and I fix them in space, these two red points. and there are some field lines drawn around it, and you clearly see that this field is not homogeneous. So this simple object, that will now be the representation of our electron cloud. These two fixed point charges deliver a non-homogeneous electric field at the position of the nucleus. We put our nucleus there, which is the ellipsoid, and I introduce some symbols. The distance between these two classical electrons is 2D. The orientation of the nucleus with respect to the vertical axis is given by an angle theta. And the charge of these two negative objects is twice minus E. I will even replace the nucleus by something that is still simpler. Instead of an ellipsoid, I take two positive point charges connected by a neutral rod. They are a distance 2L away from each other, and each of these blue points has a charge plus E. So we have a very classical atom, a simple classical atom. This system is so simple that it is straightforward to write down the electrostatic interaction energy. This is a first year exercise. You calculate the Coulomb energy for a specific orientation of this nucleus, and you find the equation here at the bottom. So this energy depends on several geometrical properties of this problem and the orientation angle theta. Depending on how your nucleus is oriented, the energy will be lower or higher. And the entire graph is given here at the left. So you see for all possible orientations going from 0 to 180 degrees, what is this electrostatic energy? The nucleus or the system is in its ground state when it is parallel to the axis that connects the two electrons. And the highest energy situation is the one where the nucleus is perpendicular to this axis. Again, all possible orientations are allowed. All angles theta can appear, which is again symbolized by this black square. And now we play the same game. Our nucleus, our real nucleus, is a quantum system. So you have a discrete set of orientations. And in the case of a nucleus of spin 1, it turns out that only two possible energies can appear, the lowest one and the highest one. The lowest energy is for the two quantum numbers plus and minus 1. So when the nucleus is parallel or antiparallel to the z-axis, and the highest energy is when the nucleus is perpendicular to the z-axis. The Hamiltonian that describes this interaction is a bit more complicated than for the magnetic case, but can be derived, is well known. So it depends on a property of the nucleus, which is this nuclear quadrupole moment, a mathematical object that describes how the nucleus is deformed from a sphere, and the electric field gradient, which gives you the gradient of the electric field at the position of the nucleus, the non-homogeneity of the electric field. So we can summarize the electric quadrupole interaction as follows. We have a nuclear property at the left, an electron property at the right. Both properties are now no vectors, but they are tensors of rank 2. You need 5 degrees of freedom to describe the shape of the nucleus. You need 5 degrees of freedom to describe the gradient of the electric field. But what still is the same, if you take the dot product between these two tensor objects, then you get an energy. And again, this energy can be measured experimentally. Wien2k cannot calculate these quadrupole moments, but Wien2k can calculate these electric field gradients. How is that done? Well, you don't have to do much effort because it is calculated by default in the SCF cycle. If you go to the keywords EFG for every atom and eta for every atom, and if you look in the SCF file to the information that is right below these two keywords, where you have what is called the orientation of the principal axis system, well, together you have all the 5 degrees of freedom of the electric field gradient tensor. I refer here to the user's guide and to some papers where you can find more explanations about this. Mostly people are interested in this EFG keyword. That is usually what is reported in the experimental papers as well. Then we come to the last object, the isomer shift or the monopole shift. That is related to the volume of the nucleus. And we go again to our classical system, the two electrons with a dumbbell-like nucleus in between. And I plot there, and on that curve, the same curve that I have derived on the previous slides, the electrostatic energy as a function of orientation. Now I will change this system a little bit, and I try to mimic what S-electrons do. S-electrons have a non-zero probability to appear inside the nucleus. So let me put here a tiny electric charge epsilon, a negative charge, inside the nucleus. And now you calculate the extra electrostatic energy due to the interaction of this minus epsilon with these two positive charges, depending on the orientation of the nucleus. Now, you immediately see that however you orient the nucleus, that interaction energy will be the same, because the distance between all these charges remains constant. And that turns out to be this extra contribution to the electrostatic energy. So the original graph that we had there in blue just shifts rigidly by a constant amount. Let's play a bit with these numbers. So this extra addition, I just repeated there on top, and I multiply numerator and denominator by L squared. L was half of the length of the nucleus. And then I rearrange these terms a little bit. And what do we recognize? We have a term L squared there, which you could interpret as the mean square radius of the nucleus. Not exactly, but it's analogous. And the factor that comes in front of this, the extra charge inside the nucleus divided by L to the power 3, that gives you a measure for the electron density inside the nucleus. L to the power 3 is roughly the volume of the nucleus, and epsilon was the charge, the electron charge inside the nucleus, so divide them by each other, and you have the electron density inside the nucleus. So you get a product, this extra correction is a product between the electron charge density in the nucleus times the mean square radius of the nucleus. And so that is the effect due to the volume of the nucleus. We can summarize that in the same way. We have the nuclear property, which is now a scalar, a simple number, mean square radius, and we have the electron property, which is also a scalar. You make the dot product, which in this case is a simple regular product, and that gives you an energy that in some situations can be measured. It's not as straightforward. You cannot measure this in one material. You always need to measure it in two and compare the difference. But that is the basic principle behind this isomer shift. Also, this isomer shift, this charge density at the nucleus, is calculated in every SCF cycle. So if you go to the RTO keyword for every atom, you find that information there. No extra effort needed. If we summarize them all together, we have now a complete picture of all our hyperfine interactions. I have ordered them according to the rank of the mathematical objects, a scalar, a vector, and a tensor of rank 2. We always have a nuclear property that goes beyond a point charge. We have the volume of the nucleus, the magnetic moment of the nucleus, and the shape of the nucleus. Wien 2K cannot calculate these. This is information that comes from nuclear physics. But Wien 2K can calculate the corresponding electron properties, the charge density at the nucleus, the magnetic field at the nucleus, and the gradient of the electric field at the nucleus. I will not tell much about how these hyperfine interactions can be measured. Just give you the message that there is a whole zoo of experimental techniques that can do that. And one of these experimental techniques is called NQR, nuclear quadrupole resonance. And that's the method that is used in some of these luggage scanners. How does that work? Well, it's a method that measures this electric quadrupole interaction. So remember, this is how the energy level splits under this electric quadrupole interaction. And what can be measured experimentally is this transition energy, which is in the radio wave region. So you send radio waves to your sample. The nuclei absorb these radio waves if they have the right frequency, and these are used to flip the orientation of the nucleus. Now, how do they use that in a luggage scanner? For some chemical coincidence, all major explosives contain nitrogen. Whether you take Semtex or RDX or TNT, they all have nitrogen, and more specifically nitrogen-oxygen bonds. That stores a lot of energy. So here you see the molecule, that is the molecule in TNT. The blue atoms, the three blue atoms, are the nitrogen atoms. And the nucleus of one of the isotopes of nitrogen, nitrogen 14, is very well suited to apply this NQR technique. So what do? They send a spectrum of radio waves to your luggage. The nitrogen nuclei absorb these, and the frequencies that they absorb, the detailed frequencies that they absorb, that depends on which electric field gradient is felt by that nitrogen nucleus. And you will have three different local environments, so three different field gradients, so three different sets of frequencies will be absorbed. And that's a fingerprint for that particular molecule. So in this way, they can detect how this luggage contains an explosive. They have a library of all these frequencies for all known explosives. And that's a non-destructive, quick way to check what is inside your luggage. Between 2K, you can calculate these field gradients. And in principle, you would be able to predict for a molecule that you didn't measure yet, what are the resonance frequencies that you can expect. And that is the way how such calculations are used in combination with experimental work. I don't know any specific application for explosives, but for instance, in semiconductor physics, where you dope a semiconductor with an impurity element, and that impurity will then perhaps associate with a vacancy or with a different impurity. Well, you can do these experiments and measure what is the quadrupole interaction, but you don't know in advance which environment will be felt by that impurity. Is it near to a vacancy? Is it near to a grain boundary? And one way how you could guess which environment the impurity feels is simulate that environment by Wien2K, predict the electric field gradient, and see which of your simulated environments gives an electric field gradient that corresponds with the experimental measurement. So this combination of experiment and a set of calculations can teach you something about the local environment of an impurity in a solid. I started this talk by asking, who cares about hyperfine interactions? I hope that I have convinced you that if you care about, say, flying, then you have to care somewhat about hyperfine interactions as well. That was it about hyperfine interactions. I'm ready to take your questions.